So there are certain examples of how do you use English as a language, how do you talk, how do you effectively speak and communicate with your clients. And here is a video which talks about the English used in restaurants and hotel. Have a nice watch here and observe the body language too.
Good morning. Welcome to the Transnational Hotel. What can I do for you?
Good morning. My name is Tom Sanders. I have a reservation for a single room for 3 nights.
All right, Mr. Sanders, let me pull up your reservation. I can't seem to find a record of your booking. Did you book the room directly through us, or do you use a hotel reservation service or a travel agent?
Well, I booked it directly through you. I've already also paid a deposit on the first night. I have a reservation number, if that helps.
Yeah, sure. Can I see that, please? Thank you. Oh, I see. Maybe there was a glitch with the booking system. Well, we don't have any more single rooms available, with the exception of one adjoined room, but you would then be right next door to a family with children, which might get noisy. But that's not a problem. I can upgrade you to one of our business suites. They all come with jacuzzis.
Oh, that sounds nice. But how much more is that going to cost?
That would, of course, be at no extra charge to you.
Oh, well, thank you.
My pleasure.
What about the wireless internet?
Oh, it's really easy. This is your access code and instructions on how to use it. If you have any problems, feel free to call the front desk. And this is a list of all the hotel amenities, like the gym and the indoor pool.
Ah, thank you very much.
You're welcome. Has the valet already taken your car, or will you be needing a parking pass?
Oh, I don't have a car. I took a taxi direct from the airport.
Oh, all right. Could I have some form of ID, please? And could you just fill out this registration form?
Sure. Here's my driver's license.
Thank you. Oh, you're from San Francisco.
Yes, I am, all the way from the West Coast.
I hope you had a good trip.
Yes, I did. Thank you. The flight was long, but it was smooth, and I slept almost the whole way.
Oh, and is this your first time in the Big Apple?
Yes, it is. I have a business conference to attend, but I'm looking forward to getting some sightseeing done as well.
Well, I'd be more than happy to give you some sightseeing tips if you need any.
Thank you.
All right, I've got you all checked into your room. This is your room key. You're in room 653. Just take the elevator on the right up to the 6th floor. When you get off the elevator, turn right. Your room is at the end of the corridor on the left-hand side. Just leave your suitcase here and the bellboy will bring it up.
Great. Well, thank you very much.
If you need anything, please feel free to dial the front desk. Enjoy your stay.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
So like you saw, that there is a polite way in which the person was, giving answers, solving the queries, and always having a smile on the face, right? So there are different ways in which other person will respond. If you want to be an effective speaker, you must make sure that you have polite ways and polite way of inquiry and responses both. So for both the things, I'm here showcasing two more examples to you.
Welcome back to English at Work. We're still in Anna's first week in the busy offices of Tip Top Trading.
How's it going, Anna?
Everything's still so new to me. I keep needing to ask people for help.
Well, that's only natural at the beginning. To ask people politely for help, use the words would and could. You can also use the word please. But don't make the mistake of thinking that's enough to make what you say polite.
Okay.
Hello, Anna.
Oh, hi, Paul.
I was wondering if you could do something for me.
Yes, of course.
Would you be able to print out a file for me? It's a document on CBL, Convincing Bananas Limited. They're one of our suppliers. The file should be on the system, and could I have it in the next 10 minutes, please, as they're on their way here for a meeting?
Yes. Oh, no. I have no idea how to find it. Tom?
Ask Denise. She should know.
Okay, thanks, Tom. I'll ask her.
I'd warned her, you know. I said, Victoria, if you don't change your hairdresser...
Denise?
One day you'll... hold on a moment. Anna?
Please email me the background file of CBL. Thank you.
Who does that girl think she is? Anna. New girl. I told you about her. Yes, with the saucepans. That's the one. She's only been here 5 minutes and she's already acting like the Queen of Sheba.
Oh, and Denise, please send it to me within 5 minutes. Paul needs it soon. Thank you.
Well, honestly.
Good to see who's the boss, eh, Denise?
Really?
Anna, I think you've upset Denise.
Upset Denise?
You were a bit rude when you asked her for help.
Was I?
Remember what I said, Anna? Just using please to ask someone to do something can sound a little rude.
Oh.
Instead of saying, please send me the file, you could say, could you possibly send me the file? Or, would you mind sending me the file?
Oh, English is so confusing. I'll try to remember that. Oh no, the printer isn't even set up. Tom?
Yeah?
Please help me with... I mean, could you possibly help me with the printer?
I really need to finish this email. It's to a really important new client.
But it's really urgent. Would you mind writing your email later?
Okay, since you asked so nicely, let's have a look.
Well, it's a good thing Anna has understood how to use could and would to ask for things before she upsets anyone else. Let's hear those phrases again.
I was wondering if you could do something for me. Would you be able to print out a file for me? Could I have it within 10 minutes, please?
Could you possibly help me with a printer? Would you mind writing your email later?
The printer seems to be working well, but how well are Anna and Denise working together? Are these two going to be enemies?
Really? Denise, do this. Denise, do that. I'm telling you, Sharon, I've almost had enough. I get treated like some kind of servant.
Now, while we were looking at these videos, we found that there are different kinds of speakers. Each character in the video was a different kind of speaker. So, on the basis of that, we realized that three types of public speaking might be happening. So, there are speeches written. Some speeches, first kind is that speeches that inform you. When I say speeches that inform you, that speech might be written to explain the concept. For example, if I say that you have to write or you have to talk about a speech where you're talking about importance of attendance in the classroom, you will be explaining, right? You'll be explaining the education system in India, why attendance is essential, and so on and so forth. So it is a speech that informs. The second point could be speech that reports. So there is this pandemic that is there. So in India, say, there could be a possibility of a speech given by Prime Minister where he's giving you data, where he's giving you information about how many cases have been reported of COVID in India over a period of time, and so on and so forth, right? Then there could be speeches that describe. So when you have to talk about a particular description of how women have been treated in our country, or it could be a description of a beautiful place for tourism industry, if you are asked to speak about one area of yours that to which you belong, or you know, tourism, about if you want to ask people, request people, convince them about it, that India is a beautiful country and you must visit here, then it will be descriptive in nature. The next kind would be clarify. Certain speeches would be related, specifically political speeches. As you find, there are questions asked by news reporters and you clarify, right? So those are speeches to do that. Then there is speeches written particularly to define a particular concept. You might have seen that a lot of videos were produced on Kova Punjab channel, on Arogya Setu app, which talk about what is COVID, what is this pandemic all about. So they are related to defining. So speeches that define the particular element. The second kind is speeches that persuade you. When I say persuasion, it is an art where you're trying to convince somebody about your viewpoint. Where these kind of speeches are designed to convince and influence certain people, their belief systems, their attitudes. So most of these, you might talk about WHO giving speeches. Certain representatives who are giving speech in WHO will be trying to persuade you. When you have elections in the country, most of the candidates are trying to persuade you that you must give me vote for so and so reason. So those logical development would be there for speech that persuades you. Then there are certain speeches written to entertain you. You might have seen that we have the culture of stand-up comedy in India now, and you have a different kind of audience there. You have wit and humor largely used by the speaker there. And wit and humor has also been used by very famous people in the world, around the world, to even catch the attention of the speaker, of the audience. So when I say that three main speaking styles could be there, we could understand that you have certain people who can be in the category of cool presenters, who are not nervous, who know their content, and who are giving you the delivery on the basis of their speech that they have been able to prepare. Then there are hot presenters. Hot presenters could be, parliamentary debates that you see. You see it that in parliament there are several ministers who are giving you speeches. So that could be a hot debate, hot discussion. So those are hot presenters. Then there are certain presenters who are very dull presenters, who might not be sounding very interesting to you, who might just not use non-verbal language, who might just use one tone that is called monotone and will not have any voice modulation. So please make sure you try and pick whether you want to be a cool presenter, hot presenter, or dull presenter. Now, when I say, this art of presentation is important, you must also know that you draft your speeches by knowing who are your target audience, which is the group that you're going to address. So sometimes you might address your superiors. So you will begin your speech by saying respected panelists, respected members on board. And then you will greet them and talk about what is it that you're going to talk about. Right? Tell them what you're going to tell them in the next 10 minutes. Then you might have your peers. So with your peers, you might use wit and humor as well. With your team members as well, you could do that. Special interest groups could also be there. So you have NGO activities that are being organized by the university where you go and speak to a larger audience there, because it might be a group of students. You have gone to school to do some kind of a social activity and you interact with them. So how do you address? Because you are a senior person as well, but you are interacting with them, sharing with them your experience of how does it feel, the joy of sharing. That could be one example for it. The other thing could be that it could be a mixed group. You might not be, you might have people ranging from various age groups, okay? So your content should be somewhere designed around it, that who are your audience group. Now, on this last slide, as you see, I am very clearly giving you a pyramid that you could follow as the thumb rule for effective public speaking. Your speech should be very practical. Your speech should make sure that you utilize not only the verbal delivery, that is the choice of words and the choice of content in terms of writing your speech, but it should also involve non-verbal delivery, which uses your hand gestures, your eyebrows, the way you are using your smile to convince your audience. And we will have another session as well designed for you on nonverbal communication. You could refer to that for details. Now, speech preparation, as we talk about, you must make sure you are doing enough research to collect your material so that your speech is authentic. You must organize the data that you have collected, and after organization, support the idea. As you have a burger, the speech could also have a burger structure. So at the top of the bread, you see there is a loaf of bread in a burger. That could be your introduction. And since it is your burger, you choose if you want a layer of onion, you want a layer of cheese, whichever way you like. So you have the first idea, second idea, third idea put into that that speech organization, and then you close it with a conclusion. So follow this burger structure theory when you start writing your speech script. Then you should make sure that you have the foundation. Public speaking foundation can be laid only on the basis of the fact that you have a purpose for your speech. You must have an agenda. What is it that you primarily want your audience to connect with? You must select a topic of your choice, because this is where your passion will be reflected. Then you must also make sure you do the audience analysis well in time. You know carefully who are your audience. On that note, I hope that you practice and develop on the first step towards effective speaking. I'll see you soon in the next lecture, where we are going to discuss how to become better speakers.